Wonderful. Welcome all to Oxford Brookes University and to the Italy and its Audiences Conference. It's really great to have you all here. And welcome to this building. I think I want to say a couple of things about this beautiful building. It's the only old building that we have at Brookes. So I just want to say that. It used to actually was built for the Morrell family, so you're probably here as one of the local brewers. And what I want to tell you about this building is that apparently Oscar Wilde was here for a fancy dress ball in the hall. I thought that's a piece of news that you need to have, so when you go around, just imagine him in his fancy dress. I don't know, I thought that's important. Right, our Italian Cinema Audiences Conference, sort of a project, is really coming to an end, and what we wanted to do with the conference was obviously celebrate the project and all its partners, and we will be doing that tomorrow in the afternoon. But we also wanted to gather researchers that were working on audiences in Italy. So when we said, was actually, we sent the call for paper, and we were really very surprised and very pleasantly surprised to see so many people working on a similar subject area. And I just feel that the conference, in a way, will probably challenge a sort of an overstated argument that audience studies is still neglected within Italian film and cultural studies. And the very wide range of sort of topics that are going to be presented in the next couple of days, I think will show that. We have paper on investigating audience as consumers on film, television, but also music, analyzing audiences in the context of feature-length film, but also short films and passo ridotto. We have a paper that will look at the relationship between audiences, industrial strategies, state funding, stardom, fandom, diasporic and transnational audiences, but also methodological issues, such as big data, which is something we're very interested in, digitization, and lots of other aspects that hopefully will be covered in the next 2 days. So I'm very sort of excited about the program, and obviously we've got three extraordinary keynotes that I really want to thank. I will thank them throughout the 2 days, but I really want to say thank you for coming, because they are going to sort of expert in audiences studies that will bring their knowledge and sort of guide us through muddy waters of audiences that we sort of we navigate. Well, we've been navigating that for a few years, and we still feel they're pretty muddy, you know. So thank you very much. So a lot to sort of get excited about. Let me, before I present our first keynote, to give you a few practical issues. As you probably have guessed, we are filming the event. We've had quite a few people that have emailed us and said that they were really sad and not to be able to be here, and they really were keen to sort of be part of the conference. So hopefully we will put the video on our website, and if you have issues with that, beyond Catherine and Silvia, that I know they do, but I'm ignoring that, if anybody has an issue, come and talk to us, but I hope that you'll be all right. It's a very discreet, not really, quite discreet camera. Lunch and breaks will be in the dining room that you have seen where you've had your coffee. We will tell you a little bit more about the conference dinner later on throughout the day. Fire exit and toilets are here, and Bobby's found them, but I'm sure you will be able to discover them. And we've only got one change of program for tomorrow. I'm sure Silvia will remind you, but unfortunately Federico Vitella will not be here. I don't know if you know, but he was stuck at Catania Airport with a worn-out document, and he wasn't allowed to go through. I just hope this is not the beginning of Brexit. The first sign of. We are having, instead of Federico, a wonderful presentation by Sarah Culhane on female stardom and the absent audiences, so you will have a great sort of a paper there. I just want to really stop here and just give time. I don't really want to take any more time, and I just want to introduce Robert Allen, that is our first keynote. I am so pleased. Bobby has been our inspiration for the project. You will see some fantastic examples of his work. If you have not done this, you have to, by the end of the conference, go and see certainly is a wonderful project. Going to the show, an online digital resource documentary, the history of movie going in North Carolina, that for us has been a real sort of inspiration. We will never get there, but that's where we were looking as an example. Bobby's professor of American Studies at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Teaching and research interests are broad and interdisciplinary. His focus on American cultural history and the application of digital technologies to history and the humanities more in generally. He has written extensively, not only on film history and historiography, but also on radio and television and popular American theater. He's also director, still director.
I ended my term as director on June 30th.
Oh! Of the Digital Innovation Lab. Oh. Which, yes, very connected to the lab. And again, we have used on it in the Italian cinema audience, we have used part of the DH Press that I think will come in Bobby's talk, which is a wonderful open source, the digital humanities software platform. I've also discovered the Digital Lorry, which is really the most what has been defined the most ambitious digital public humanities project with incredible timelines, interactive map, extraordinary wealth of material that has been presented in to interpret and document the complex history of Gastonia, the North Carolina iconic Lorry Mill and the surrounding Mill Village. I think we will talk some of the things that Bobby will refer, well, certainly we will bring them back in our presentation on community engaged digital public history, but also on aspects of sort of a representation and study of experience of cinema. Bobby's paper is titled A Few Comments on a Little Class Exercise, Reimagining the First Decade on Cinema History. Thank you.
Thank you, Danielle, very much. I'm very, very glad to be able to be here. When I told my colleagues at UNC that I was coming to the UK to give a keynote paper at a conference on post-war Italian cinema audiences, their response was unanimously one word, you. And I can understand how they might question my bona fides as someone to not only attend, but to address a conference on Italian cinema audiences post-World War II. I certainly claim no expertise whatsoever on any of the subdomains represented by that conjoined title, although I did refer to Francesca Vertini in one paper I wrote on Austin Nielsen about 35 years ago. So if that qualifies me, I'm happy to claim that I'm not a complete fraud. What I want to do today is to talk with you about kind of broader issues having to do with audience, about cinema as a form of experience and the history of that experience, about how we represent audience and experience, about how we might use digital technologies to do this, and about how we might link our teaching and our research and our engaged scholarship together so that we realize synergies from these three aspects of our academic practice rather than seeing them as separate silos that we somehow have to negotiate as we try to decide how to spend the time of our day. During the spring semester, this past spring semester, I taught for the fifth time a course that I call Main Street Carolina, and the course has several interlocking goals. As I tell students in the syllabus, I want them to develop a deeper understanding of the history of everyday life and urban space in our state, and by extension in the American South over the last 125 years or so, and to explore the use of digital technologies for identifying, collecting, organizing, interpreting, representing, and sharing the history of that everyday life. Through bi-weekly research assignments, students explore such topics as the regional migration after the Civil War from farm to town, from an agrarian to an industrial economy, the spread of consumer culture, the transformation of the urban environment, everyday life in cotton mill villages, the migration of Lebanese Jews, Italians, and Greeks to North Carolina, and the regendering of Main Street through the rise of department stores and tea rooms. And running all through these assignments every semester is the critical role of race in every aspect of social, political, cultural, and economic life in every town and city in North Carolina. The development of the modern urban South is coterminous with the reign of Jim Crow. And all of these are just screenshots from the website, and I can give you that link. All the work my students do is public, published as a blog, so anybody can read it, and they know that anyone could be reading their work. The increasing availability of digitized primary resource material in our library prompted me to create search assignments that attempt to recover millions of people who've been invisible in the historical record, and to reveal aspects of social and cultural history that have never been the subject of academic historiography. Each student adopted a particular town or city in North Carolina and performed a series of what we called excavations on that town over a semester to reveal commonalities with other towns, but also to probe the distinctive features and particularities of their town at a particular moment in its past. And wherever, because 82% of our students are from the state of North Carolina, I assign my students their hometown, so they're actually studying the place in which they live. In planning the latest offering of this course, I was particularly keen to take advantage of the recent digitization of the university collection of local newspapers published in North Carolina, one of the largest such collections in the world, 3.7 million pages of more than 4,000 newspapers. In 2013, I cheered on discussions, which is to say I lobbied hard to the point of really annoying the people I was working with. I cheered on discussions between our Special Collections Library and Ancestry.com, which led to the digitization of all 3.7 million pages of local North Carolina newspapers held by our Special Collections Library. The digitization was done in less than 6 months at no cost to the library. All library patrons can access, borrow, and search the papers through the library's website and download individual pages or clip individual art. Now, in return, newspapers.com, which is the subsidiary of one of the newspapers, gets to use these newspapers as part of their subscription-based service. That which I'll say a little bit more later. Daniela was kind enough to mention going to the show. We published this in 2009, and students on that project, paid students, searched some of these newspapers, but those newspapers were then only available on microfilm to map early cinema venues. And this was, as I knew from my own research, an extremely tedious and time-consuming form of research. Documenting itinerant cinema exhibitions prior to the opening of storefront theaters was even more difficult to research. I had a student go through national trade papers for this decade, but this really didn't yield very much beyond the occasional cinema performance. So I had to leave behind this important moment in the history of cinema exhibition and leave it buried amongst the millions of unindexed and very hard to serve pages of local newspapers on my. So for my Main Street class this semester, I devised an experiment to see what my 17 students could discover about itinerant exhibition in North Carolina at the turn of the century, particularly in their adopted towns and cities that we were focusing on, using primarily digitized newspapers to which they had access. Their towns, which ranged in population from a few thousand to 25,000 in 1900, had been chosen because I knew that they had good digitized newspaper coverage, as well as good coverage in digitized city directories, Sanborn fire insurance maps, and other digital sources. And together, these 17 towns are broadly representative of the only 28 towns that had populations of at least 1,000 in North Carolina at the beginning of the 20th century. This is a railroad map for North Carolina for 1900, which you will see again. Although North Carolina was urbanizing at a rapid pace, it was still very rural. 2.2 million people spread out over 48,000 square miles, or roughly the size of Belgium, the Netherlands, and Denmark put together, and which stretches some 550 miles from the Atlantic Ocean to the Appalachian Mountains, or roughly the distance from Antwerp to Prague. This was the first primary source research assignment of the semester for these undergraduate students, and they ranged from first-year students to graduating seniors, none of whom was a cinema studies major, none of whom had done any historical research of any kind, so far as I knew. They effectively had a week to complete the assignment, supported by only two 90-minute workshops on early cinema history that I did in class. We found that in the spring and summer of 1897, early cinema exhibitions were held in a number of cities, including the largest ones in the state. North Carolina was a city of many small towns and very few large cities at the turn of the century. Wilmington here had 25,000 inhabitants and was the largest. No city had a large enough white middle class theater-going population to support regular vaudeville theater, but most of the larger towns did have opera houses, which were typically the largest secular meeting space in town, were frequently built on the second story of the city hall building. The opera house was leased to a manager who booked traveling dramatic and comedy shows, variety troupes, and minstrel shows. And it was in this context that the first movie picture exhibitions were presented. So the absence of regular vaudeville theaters that were bringing national acts into the town every week or every other week meant that almost all cinema exhibitions in North Carolina prior to the advent of storefront theaters in 1906 were brought to town by someone else from somewhere else and stayed only a few days before the traveling exhibitor took his strangely named projector and precious reels of films to another town down the train line. My students discovered that in some cases the name of the showman was also included in newspaper ads and coverage of the earliest exhibitions, and one name appeared most frequently, the felicitously named Arthur Leroy Butt. And here you can see clippings that they had taken out of individual newspapers from newspapers.com, and they were able to embed these in their blog posts so that you could go directly from the blog post back to newspapers.com to see where this came from. My students discovered that in some cases the name of the show now called Bracket. Now we were able to turn from a browse and discover strategy to a targeted search strategy. Looking for any appearance of Mr. Butt in the newspapers in the statewide digital collection. His name was mentioned more than 600 times between November 5th, 1872 and December 12th, 1919. And for the purpose of my little class exercise, we restricted our search for him to 1897 and 1898, which still turned up 59 ads or articles in 16 different newspapers. We discovered that Butt had been responsible for the first commercial exhibition of motion pictures in most of the towns my students were studying. Where the town had an opera house, he would book it for a few days, but if it was not available, he also gave his entertainments, as they were called, at the county courthouse, in a tent, in vacant lots, a resort hotel, at schools and churches, including the state school for the deaf and dumb, and in the open air at amusement parks. And nearly all of the shows were for the benefit of local organizations. My students were delighted when we discovered that he was responsible for the first movie exhibition on the UNC campus on November 13, 1897. Now, I know from my colleagues Charlie Musser and Kathy Fuller and Greg Waller and others who have written about itinerant exhibition at this time that we should expect Archie Shepard and Lyman Howe to appear in North Carolina at this period, because they were certainly very prominent itinerant showmen and who worked on the regional, if not national, level. Neither, however, seems to have toured North Carolina until 1904, and neither very extensively. So North Carolina was not getting national and regional exhibitors coming to the state on a regular basis during this decade. But prompted by our discovery of Arthur Butt, we looked for other North Carolina exhibitors and found several more. This is an ad for a man named Jethro Allman. Many more North Carolinians were introduced to motion pictures by him than by Shepard or Howe. He toured the state with his Bible and movie exhibition from 1904 to 1914. Throughout 1900 and 1901, the Reverend S.F. Conrad, like Allman from the Piedmont section of North Carolina, appears to have given the first movie picture shows in dozens of towns across the state. The ability to search across newspapers published in dozens of towns and cities over extended periods means that we're able to trace the itineraries of these three exhibitors from 1 week to the next and from 1 year to the next. It is also possible to recover what attraction played at a local opera house in the weeks prior to or after the showman's performance, and to gauge the frequency with which audiences would have had the opportunity to see any movies shown by anyone over a period of a decade or more of cinema history. So it's really important to underscore what a historiographic breakthrough this represents. As anyone who has tried to do so will attest, it is very difficult to trace the circulation of itinerant performative culture at the turn of the century, or any time for that matter, outside the metropolitan areas. The theatrical and cinema trade coverage did not reach down to the level of the small town opera house or the tour routes of small regional showmen. And yet, we know that most people living in the U.S. in 1900 lived outside any urban area. So it is no wonder that our understanding of how most people in the U.S. became acquainted with something we call cinema is still very much dilemmatic. I appreciate that my students and I occupy a privileged historiographic position by being able to call upon 3.7 million pages of local newspapers for the state in which we live and work. However, the annual subscription fee for the full version of newspapers.com, 157 million pages, is $80, or the equivalent of one night's hotel cost at an archive not near you, or the cost of a biology textbook. And the last few years has seen a flood of digitized newspapers projects, some produced by for-profit and others by non-profit organizations. Chronicling America is a joint effort between the National Endowment for the Humanities and the Library of Congress, which has already digitized about 11 million pages of pre-1923 newspapers. And there are many other on an international scale that are in the works or have already been launched. And they're actually tracked by a very useful website and organization called ICON, the International Coalition on Newspapers. So some of the collections that they point to are the Europeana collection, newspaper collection of 10 million pages, the Trove Project, some of you might know, in Australia, 18 million pages, the National Library of Singapore, National Library of Wales, British Libraries, Newspapers Archive. All of these represent major digitization efforts that are realizing a flood a new primary source material for us to look at and to take advantage of. So it is now possible for us and for our students to also leverage increasingly these newspapers, but also additional primary document, digitized primary source material. In our case, Firestone map, Sanborn fire insurance maps, city directories, and through Ancestry.com, which our library has a subscription to as well, more than 15 billion genealogical. Now, I was trained in the Dark Ages to work in an era of data scarcity and resource and remoteness. But increasingly, I'm having my students lead me through the challenges and possibilities of a data environment, which means, a data environment of data ubiquity and hyper-abundance. For all of us working on the history of the experience of cinema over the last 40 years, we are inevitably drawn to those sources that are available and which we believe that cinema is going to be a primary object. Almost certainly meant just the opposite, that African Americans were excluded from these exhibitions and that this practice was so deep. There were hundreds of instances of what Said has called the normalized quiet of unseen power. The profound silence across every one of 10,000s of pages of newspapers across every day for more than a decade across every town, many of which were 30% African American. This was a discovery more significant than anything my students learned about cinema. Looking at the discourse about early cinema as part of a discursive universe dedicated to chronicling social, political, economic, and cultural life on a daily basis and at a very granular level gives us a better sense of the relative prominence and cultural importance of cinema relative to other cultural forms. For example, my students kept bumping into ads for minstrel shows, and so I had tried to explain to them what a blackface minstrel show was. And I think if we had pursued it a little bit further, we would have found that the minstrel show was by far the most popular form of theatrical entertainment in North Carolina at the turn of the century. We could have gone back and counted the number of days that minstrel companies were performing at our 17 towns and compared those with the number of days that cinema shows were performing. But instead, I opted to devote 5 minutes in class to a very crude experiment in text mining. I simply counted the occurrence of the word minstrel with the most used term for cinema at the time, moving pictures. Between 1897 and 1906, across 2,217 North Carolina newspapers, Moving Pictures appeared 2,300 times. Minstrel appeared 8,902 times. When we turned our attention to the establishment of the first movie downtown storefront movie theaters in our 17 towns, we were also confronted with another discursive anomaly and another silence. As was the case in most parts of the country, storefront theaters began to crop up around 1906, and in the 36 months or so thereafter, they opened in the downtowns of smaller towns and cities across the country as well. I was particularly interested to see if there was local opposition, particularly from Protestant ministers, to the establishment of movie theaters along the main streets of their town. And did the editorial voice of the local paper or letters to the editor express concern over children or white women attending theaters? I did this against the background of Lee Greaveson's work on the Chicago Tribune in the spring of 1907, which suggests that we should have heard loud and rancorous voices raised in opposition to the establishment of Nickelodeons. In the Tribune's campaign against storefront theaters, the Tribune's campaign against storefront theaters helped to mobilize a plethora of reports and government investigations of the phenomenon of Nickelodeons that, quote, frequently included accounts that we might call phobic representations of the allegedly disorderly, panicky, and potentially criminal crowd seemingly drawn to the new Nickelodeon theaters. The provocation for this national moral panic, according to Lee Greaveson, included particular films as well as the theaters in which they played, and one of the films singled out most by the Tribune and others in the spring of 1907 was a film made by Sig Lubin called The Unwritten Law, which was based on a recent sensational murder trial of a wealthy playboy who murdered a famous architect, Sanford White. Citing coverage of the film's exhibition in the new trade paper Moving Picture World, Greaveson notes that police prevented exhibition of the film in a number of American cities, and that exhibitors showing films were convicted of imperiling the morals of young boys. Unwritten Law was, by his account, the most controversial American film made prior to 1909. In May of 1907, one of my students discovered this note in the Greensboro Daily News announcing the opening of a new storefront theater in downtown Greensboro, North Carolina, a city of about 15,000 residents. As its initial attraction, the manager chose The Unwritten Law. Here, I thought, we would surely find local ministers railing about both the film and the theater. Certainly, many people must have seen the film. At a time when storefront theaters really rarely ran a film for more than 72 hours, The Unwritten Law played at Clegg's for a month. During this time, there was, notice, in the newspaper, almost every day, but it simply described this most scandalous of films as, quote, a tersely told tale of a great tragedy, followed by a reminder that the management caters especially to the patronage of ladies and children. Not only would local ministers have had the opportunity to mount a campaign against the film and the theater in the local newspaper, but they also could have tried to stir up their co-religionists in respective statewide ministerial trade papers, the Biblical Reporter and the North Carolina Advocate. But in these papers, there was no mention of the film, or for that matter, commentary about the growth of storefront movie theaters. Indeed, from North Carolina newspapers in general, we do not hear accounts of youth being led to delinquency in movie theaters or the express of working class audiences. The silence we do hear suggests to me that storefront theaters in towns and cities in North Carolina rather quickly and unproblematically settled into an unremarkable and socially comfortable role in these urban environments, one key aspect of which was the establishment of the same kind of cozy relationship other downtown businesses had with local newspapers and civic and religious leaders. In the spring of 1907, the Chicago Tribune was screaming that there were, quote, a number of little girls who should have been playing with dolls who were ruined through going to nickel newspapers. The North Carolina Christian Advocate, this is the statewide newspaper for Methodists, reported that a benefactor of the local orphanage had arranged an outing for the children to go to the state capital, Raleigh. One little girl reported that the group's first stop was Wyatt and Lassiter's moving picture shows. Quote, they showed many pretty pictures. Then she said the group went to meet the governor. In following local itinerant showmen, the first storefront theaters through newspapers, my students and I kept bumping up against the relationship between early cinema and religion at every turn. This is what is probably the first black itinerant showman who is African American and a minister. and that's the show we did in Elizabeth City, North Carolina. My students noted a number of films with religious subject matter that played in their towns, particularly one or more versions of the Passion Play. And as you may know, between 1898 and 1907, there were several film versions of the Ober Ammergau Passion Play. Each was made up of individual one-shot scenes purporting to depict a corresponding scene from this pageant on the life of Jesus. And Schilling would buy sets of films and put together a multimedia program of them. In their very useful book on itinerant showmen, Lyman Howe, Musser and Carol Nelson claimed that Methodists, the most frequent sponsors of Howe's exhibits, were strongly opposed to amusement in any form. And they take as their evidence for this an edict from the National Methodist Conference in 1896. For Howe and for other early itinerants, according to them, the challenge was how to negotiate the relationship between the religious sensibilities of their audiences on the one hand and the showman's commercial secular interests. And one strategy for doing this was to partner with a local church group in an exhibition. What then to make of this? This is A.L. Butts, an ad for A.L. Butts exhibition in Charlotte in 1897. An alternating program of biblical and temperance panoramas and secular moving pictures on consecutive days for the benefit of J.F. Butts Church. And what was the connection between A.L. Butt and J.F. Butt? Well, we can trace the careers of both men through hundreds of newspapers, articles, and ads over the last quarter of the century. Born in 1849, A.L. Butt became a portrait and sign painter in the mid-1870s in Charlotte. And in the late 1890s, he painted more than 20 10 by 12 foot paintings depicting the apocalyptic visions of St. John on Patmos as described in the Book of Revelations. And these have actually been preserved at the North Carolina Museum of History. Absolutely extraordinary. The paintings were stitched together and mounted on rollers to form what was called a moving panorama. And in performance, the paintings would have been scrolled through left to right, while Butt read the scripture describing the scene and played and provided commentary. And his wife was the pianist for the performance, and she had accompaniment for the lectures. Butt toured his panorama in North Carolina and across the South from the early 1880s to large audiences and produced two sequels, one based on the Old Testament, one on a temperance tract. He toured the state for more than 30 years, from 1880 to 1916, playing towns multiple times. Most of his performances were benefits for church. J.F. Butt turns out to be A.L. Butt's father, who was born in 1825, and he had a 40-year career as a Methodist lay minister. His career is also documented in hundreds of newspapers between 1863 and his death in 1905. He's mentioned more than 1,100 times. He helped start a number of small churches, but spent most of his career traveling circuits of small communities, preaching at each one once or twice. By 1890, Butt was responsible for one of the largest circuits in conference. He was a well-known evangelist and revival leader. Typically, revivals were led by a visiting minister with a reputation for being a dynamic performer. Butt also performed in this context as a singer. He toured the state with his father and with other evangelists for Methodist revivals and camp meetings, and music, individual and choir performance, as well as congregational singing, was as important as the preaching itself to the success of the revival meeting. Maybe a little bit hard to read here, but what you see here is the Christian Advocate, in effect, giving a review of a revival in terms of the number of people who were saved in various ways. So this is a very sophisticated metric. It's a lot more sophisticated than bums on seats for giving some sense of how effective this form of religious entertainment might have been. The father and son's careers intertwined for more than a quarter of a century. The voluminous and extended documentation of their careers gives us a glimpse into what was perhaps the most widely circulated and important mode of performative culture for millions of Americans, particularly in the 19th century, what Jill Stevenson calls evangelical performance. The cinematic practice of two other North Carolina-based itinerant exhibitors, I've mentioned, Conrad and Allman, were also expressions of this deeply embedded cultural tradition. Film scholars, and I'm certainly among them, have long assumed a dichotomy, if not an antagonism, between sacred and secular culture. We have also assumed a historical trajectory going from religious observance and tradition in the 19th century to secularity and modernity in the 20th. And furthermore, I've assumed, in particular, a suspicion of movie going among evangelical Protestants in the South across most of the 20th century. And I confess that this was based on stories that my Baptist-turned-Methodist mother used to tell me about her father's insistence that his children never be seen going inside a movie theater. But my experiment this semester has led me to more recent scholarship on American religious practice and its relationship to both commodity capitalism and everyday life. In her book on material culture and Christianity, Colleen McDaniel blames Durkheim's classic study, The Elementary Forms of Religious Life in 1912, for creating an influential analytic dualism between sacred and profane worlds. If we look at what Christians do rather than what they think, she says, we cannot but help notice the continuing scrambling of sacred and profane. The Charlotte Observer commented on the success of Butt's first tour of his religious panorama in Goldsboro, where the opera house was particularly crowded. The reviewer there said that he beat the best theatrical companies in both entertainment and audiences. The largest Protestant denominations in North Carolina in the 19th century, Baptists and Methodists, were also the ones most based on what Stevenson has called evangelical entrepreneurism. Since the 18th century, she argues, American evangelism has been an entrepreneurial venture which utilized popular media in innovative ways to commodify effective personal religious experience. Historian David Morgan comments on the intersection of religious belief and entrepreneurism in biblical panoramas, which, quote, worked out the rudimentary commercial apparatus that greeted the rise of the film in the late 1890s. It's important to understand that commerce and pious entertainment were not regarded as antithetical in principle by most 19th century Americans. By the time Bud and Conrad showed their first films across North Carolina, they had between them more than 35 years experience as evangelical entrepreneurs and performers. The circuits they traveled were well-worn. The reception of whatever films they showed was no doubt conditioned by the fact that the agent responsible was not a stranger. Bud and Almond and their wives were regular visitors whose return was anticipated and welcomed. In short, at a moment when there was no stable cinema ontology to delimit what it was, its relevance, meaning, value, and possibility was a matter of how it was connected. I'm eager to keep following out these connections through new data sources, the connections amongst media forms and forms of performance that came together in these entertainments, the connections between circulation and performance of religious films, including the various versions of Passion Play, and other forms of religious performance. The connections between panoramas and other forms of visual expression, painting, stereopticon, cinema, and the role of music, particularly vocal performance, across a range of entertainments of the turn of the century. More broadly, my engagement with North Carolina newspapers supports a redefinition of the object of cinema as historical experience. In this redefinition, cinema becomes dynamic and historically situated as a set of things, including, but not limited to, films themselves, but also processes, practices, events, spaces, people, performances, connections, exchange, contestations, and memories, all of which are constitutive of cinema for those who have encountered it from its invention to the present. Through millions of pages of newspapers, we can uncover some of the ways that cinema has been reinvented billions of times through each instantiation, each activation of its connections across space and time. As the curious case of the religious dogs that didn't bark at the unwritten law suggests, the surviving versions of individual films we analyze and show in our classes are evidence, but only indirect evidence, of the historical experience of cinema. They are, as I've said many times, to use Susan Stewart's notion of the term, souvenirs. As she puts it, the souvenir exists as a sample of a now distanced experience, an experience which the object can only evoke and resonate to and can never completely recoup. Millions of accounts of instances of cinema in newspapers should remind us that cinema is and always has been experienced in particular places at particular times. Thus, carving out a space within cinema history for local history does not make sense. Cinema is local. If we understand instances of cinema to represent nodal points in dynamic networks of cultural, social, political, and economic relationships, it doesn't really matter where inquiry into the historical experience of cinema starts. It doesn't matter. Start where you want. We are at this, as pundits say, at an inflection point in cinema history's relationship with the archive. The academic literature of cinema developed over the last 40 years was produced in an archival landscape of widely scattered and relatively inaccessible institutional collections of materials, which reflected the production, formal attributes, reception, and reception of commercially produced nationally or internationally circulated films. Now, it's unlikely that there will ever be more of these institutions than there are today, that they will have more resources to do their work with. And despite film archivist heroic efforts, a lifetime of institutional preservation efforts will not result in a significant increase in the total proportion of surviving films relative to the total number of produced, particularly those performed before. From this point on, however, our practice will be increasingly organized not in relation to this archive, but to the anti-archive. An enormous, ever-growing, uncontainable miscellany of heterogeneous material produced, collected, and preserved for reasons that have little, if anything, to do with films or the people and organizations who made them. One of the implications of this explosion in the digitization of historic newspapers for cinema and historiography is that scholars teaching and research focus might be informed by the places and times when digitized newspaper collections are the richest and most accessible, rather than the places, films, or filmmakers in which individual scholars might have a personal interest. The slogan of the History Workshop here in Britain years ago was, dig where you stand. Dig into the data pile that you're standing on. Make what you do, what you find, relevant and useful, and the map that you find it on, dare I say, absolute. And map what you find to the, dare I say, rhizomatic networks on which from which the data comes. Historical insights will increasingly come from making connections and finding patterns across and within contingent and linked data sets, from visualizing relationships between data points, from using historical sources in ways they were never meant to be used. Our challenge, then, is as much a challenge of representation as it is of interpretation. How to conceive and represent the ultimately unrepresentable magnitude, diversity, and dynamism of the global historical experience of cinema. For the last 5 years, I've directed a digital humanities lab at UNC, and one emphasis of which has been the creation of flexible, easy-to-use, open-source, sustainable platforms for data collection, curation, and visualization, which the Italian Cinema Audiences team has used, one version of DH Press, to map the locations of cinema in Rome and their project. Under the direction of our technical lead, Michael Newton, we have developed a new platform that builds on DHPress called Prospect. It's a plug-in for WordPress, like DHPress was, which is one of the most commonly used content management systems in the world. It is now supported for anyone at UNC, faculty, staff, students who want to put together a WordPress website and have it hosted by the university. And it features a number of enhanced functionalities for mapping something like itinerant exhibition. And I've got a little demonstration that I can show you if we have time during the question and answer period, take about 5 minutes, to see how I've taken what I've done with Butt and Conrad and these other exhibitors and done just a little experiment with mapping them in Prospect. Finally, as the work of the Italian Cinema Audiences team suggests, increasingly our historiography in cinema will require cinema scholars to work in teams with other scholars in other fields and with practitioners from other domains of knowledge Some of them do not share our enthusiasm for cinema. In order to develop projects and to build or adapt tools that we need, another feature of this landscape is that it is not now, nor will it ever be, a land of free data, milk, and honey. The big data landscape is, in economic terms, a mixed market in which nonprofits, individual entrepreneurs, government agencies, and for-profit corporations, some of them quite large, all operate. As scholars, we can wish this were not the case, and we can agitate for open humanities data for research purposes. But an increasingly part of our job as humanities scholars will be, like a character in a Super Mario Brothers video game, to negotiate firewalls and intellectual property fences, but also, when we do find research treasures, to pick them up and be able to use them. John Reichman introduces his book, The Deleuze Connection, as, quote, a map for those whose minds or identities are not already made up, who are willing to embark on the sort of voyage where one throws out one's hermeneutic compass and leaves one's discourses behind. In other words, it is not a map in which to locate or recognize oneself in a predetermined plane with fixed coordinates. It tries to work with zones that are precisely not determined or localized, where things may go off in unforeseen directions or work in unregulated ways. For to think is to experiment, and not, in the first place, to judge. For it is through such experimentation that we escape from the nostalgia of antiquarian history, as well as the progressivism that already knows what is to come. I'm struck by the doubled and redoubled sense in which experimentation applies to the object of my students' inquiries, to the technologies they and I deploy, and to the project of film history that I see in front of myself. Each instance of cinema they found recorded in the newspapers was a unique performance. The number and variety of newspaper accounts point to the complex sets of relationships entailed in each of them, among relations among human and organizational agents responsible for the performance, among the films shown, among cinematic and non-cinematic forms, between performers and those who participated as spectators, and so on. In early cinema practice, we can see more clearly what has been true of all cinema practice, that each performance is an experiment, a new purposive act undertaken to elicit particular effects. It is the enacted response to the question, what would happen if these particular connections were instantiated? The effects of making those connections is, like those of any experience, unpredictable. As Brian Massumi, a translator of Deleuze, a commentator on him, denotes, we have a tendency to think of the terms of historical, social, and cultural relations as already constituted and preceding their related. Any given account of a film, cinema venue, performance, audience, presupposes an a priori notion of cinema, exhibition, venue, audience, that precedes the relationships among them. In effect, we quote, and I'm quoting Massumi here, we back project a stencil of the already constituted to explain its constitution, thus setting up a logical time slip, a vicious hermeneutic circle. What is given the slip, once again, is change. So if we can step back from judging in a Deleuzian sense, itinerant exhibition in North Carolina, across the first decade of commercial projected motion pictures, we can see it not only as a zone of indeterminability, but also as a period of wide variability in the experimental relations that constituted cinema. The early cinema in North Carolina, documented in digitized newspapers, enable us to see cinema becoming. Who should show films? Under whose auspices? Where? For what purpose? How often in a given place. Thus, for my students exploring early cinema as a zone of indeterminacy, this was itself an experiment because they didn't know exactly what to look for, what they might find that might turn out to be relevant to the becoming of cinema in this place. Each time they queried the newspaper database, they were conducting an experiment. An epistemological experiment, the outcome of which neither they or I could predict. the course context in which they undertook this little exercise in cinema history encouraged them, I think, to speculate about how what they found was connected not to a teleology of cinema, but to other aspects of contemporary everyday life at that time in their towns. Not being cinema students, they were less likely to pass historiographical judgment on what they found. They were unfamiliar with this teleology. They cast these itinerant showmen as soon to be marginalized and forgotten figures in the accepted national story of early cinema that congealed around the theatrical movement. They were, I think, more likely to see connections between, for example, the rather improvised spaces of first movie theaters and pop-up shops that they know from the mall. Given the unprecedented level of granularity with which my students and I were able to explore itinerant exhibition, it's tempting to think of this as another kind of experiment, an experiment in microhistory, an opportunity to place small, local objects of inquiry into larger contexts. But rather than an experiment in relating the micro level to the large level, the thing to its context, I think it's more useful to think of what we did as an experiment at in the scale at which we were able to work. Bernard Le Petit speaks of the need to develop a dynamic, multi-scalar historiography, with no scale having historiographic or explanatory precedence. Changing scales produces new insights. As Nancy Sieber has suggested in relation to architectural history, the most valuable of the most useful variants of microhistory reject deterministic historical schemes and meta-narratives and acknowledge the simultaneous contingency and autonomy of cultural forms. These variants of microhistory embrace open-ended inquiry, a preference for revealing the richness of relations over the simplicity achieved by abstractions. A search for contingency, disruption, multiple connections. Today, I'm very much attracted to a historiography and a related pedagogy of experimentation in the Deleuzian sense, an empirical practice of making connections, of placing and before is, placing and before is, relationships before ontology. Connections are not already there waiting to be discovered. So increasingly, I think that we as both scholars and teachers will have as one of our principal tasks to help make and help others make those connections. As Massumi puts it, quote, to make connections, one needs not knowledge, certainty, or even ontology, but rather a trust that something may come out, though one is not completely sure.
Sort of Italian cinema audiences is there, and what is really interesting is just not talking about. I thought it was fascinating talking about the relationship between teaching and research, and also specifically looking at students that have got not familiarity with cinema, what they could do with that. But I think that more and more we find that they really need to tap into anthropology, geography, business, and that is one aspect of it, of that sort of experiment that you're talking about. Certainly, I was sort of observing the wealth of material, and I think, yes, you are in a privileged position. And I think that Italy is very slowly catching up with, it certainly wasn't in the list of the libraries that you were mentioning, and I think that we're slowly getting there, but it is very slow. And I was thinking of some of the fascinating research that you were doing, one of which you mentioned on tracing circulation of movies, for instance, is something that for us is extremely difficult because of that lack of material. But obviously, that is one of the challenges that we really need to reflect on. But it's also what you do with the material you've got available. And I think that that's what, in a way, we sort of start with, just how we have to work on And yes, go where the material is, which is what we've been trying to do in our project. I just want to open up to a question. Sorry, I don't really want to. This is a sort of a, just a general observation of this wonderful keynote. Have we got any questions, comments on this?
I was wondering if we could see the experiment.
Sure.
Yeah.
So this is Prospect. It's a plugin for WordPress. And what I've done here is simply to chart the seasons, two seasons, one of Buck and one of Conrad, 1897 and one of 1900. And so each of these is a place marker on a georeference map of North Carolina. We actually have the railroad map superimposed on this now, but it just happened the day that I left. So we can click on any one of these locations, as I think we're about to do here. So this is Charlotte. This is Charlotte. That was Butt's home base before he operated out of. So I'm showing him go on a little local tour here. He goes down here to Pineville. He goes down to a place called Matthews. And with the inspector button, we can get some information about that. And this comes up, this information about this part of this tour comes up. As you might recognize this as a blog post. It's a WordPress blog post. So every record is a blog post. So if you had other material, you could put it there in that way. Let's look at his going to Gastonia, which I chose because that's where I grew up. That's my hometown. So we choose that, and we ask for some information about that exhibit, and it takes us to the clipping from newspapers.com. Now, if you have a subscription to newspapers.com, you can then click through this back to the original newspaper. Now, this is a bit of a magician's trick because you have to have a subscription to newspapers.com for this to work. But if you're doing it in a class environment, which I am, and which my students have subscriptions to Ancestry and to newspapers.com, they can work in this closed environment, which really, really helps with collaboration. So do we have information about the Gastonia Opera House? We do. We have a number of linked sources. This is a collection of city directories, a national collection of city directories, which is not by subscription. So we've linked to its listing there. Here's a postcard that shows the Opera House. Does it turn up in any postcard collections? Surprise, surprise, it turns up in the North Carolina postcard collection. And so we link directly to it. One thing I wasn't successful in doing, just because I was working at the last minute, was linking the Gastonia Opera House with where it appears and going to the show. It's possible to do that, but I wasn't able to do it very well. But I just kind of represented that by this map. So the Opera House shows up on the going to the show maps. And because there are multiple sets of Sanborn maps, we can see what the same space looked like before it was the Opera House. It was a fraternal hall. So we know a good deal about Gastonia, about the Opera House. We could have exposition here if we wanted to, but what do we know about Roy Budd? Arthur Roy Budd. Well, there's his picture. We have constructed a site for him in Ancestry.com, and if we're linked to Ancestry.com, it takes us to the profile here. So this is all the stuff we've been able to learn about A.L. Budd, about his children, about his parents, when they died, when they got married, when children were born. And the source information from which this is taken is also here on the screen. So we can ask, where was Budd in 1880, let's say, when his panoramas were first beginning to be shown? So we can click through to the census enumeration itself, and it will take us to the Budd family. And there is Arthur Budd, listed as an artist, and there is his father, John F. Budd, the Reverend Budd, listed as a minister. We have this brief narrative. Here's one of his panorama paintings. But we also want to link out to examples of newspaper articles or reviews of his work. I've already showed you how we've done that. So that's good for Wilmington, North Carolina. We can see what appears around that particular ad. We can also display this information in a different way. We can display it on a timeline. So we go to the timeline view, and this is, and this case, S.F. Conrad's 1901 tour with his films at the Paris Exhibition. We've also got Bud on here, but I'm just not showing that for the purposes of time. But as you can see, each one of those dots can link back to the record from which it comes. We can also just simply have a listing of all of the records that we have here if we want to. So if we wanted to work from that, we could do that. We can also have two views on the screen at once. So we might want to have the listing over here that we're referring to. We can choose particular records that we want to give special attention to by selecting them in the inspector button. And we can have two views simultaneously. So you can have the map view and the list view. You could have the timeline view and the map view or whatever, any two listings that you want to. And then finally, let me show you how this actually appears in the back end of WordPress. And I think I'm going to do that. Let's see. Yes. So if you're familiar with WordPress, this is the back end of WordPress. Here is Prospect. That's where it shows up. We go in and we look at the record, and here's the record. Each record is a post. And we can add a post. And here, we could add a new record. And this is set up for collaboration, so there are multiple levels of editing and authority. So if you were doing this as a class, you have 50 students in your class, they each could be researching the route of a particular itinerant a filmmaker and entering that information into WordPress. And then, it's not published, it has to be edited before it's published. But you could set up a publication arrangement so that you can take advantage of this kind of mini crowdsourcing that you can do in a class to get the multiple efforts of people to contribute to a particular project. So this is the link to a very rough and dirty website that I put together for this purpose that takes you to this Prospect site. It gives you a little bit more information about Prospect and what we're doing. This is only 20% of the visualizations that are possible now with Prospect. Prospect is open source, it's free, you can download it from GitHub. We have two universities in the States now for which all of their WordPress websites use Prospect. It is relatively easy to learn to use. I say that because I think people, programmers have a very different notion of what the kind of threshold is for easy to use, but it is relatively easy. So I'd be glad to talk with you individually more about how this might be used for your project. But obviously, this can be set up. You want to trace the circulation of films instead of showing them? You set it up to trace the circulation of films rather than showing them. You can add information about each of those films. So it's a very flexible tool that I think can be used for a number of different relevant applications that may be relevant.
Can I ask whether you have used it for public engagement in a sense that if you've had the public to contribute to that in any of the projects and whether Prospect offers that?
We've used Prospect, but we've used it a project that Daniela mentioned that we've been working on for 3 years. We've been working with community partners on taking what used to be the oldest cotton mill, the largest cotton mill in the state. And in the South, when it opened in 1902, which is now being refurbished as apartments in commercial and retail space. It's 630,000 square feet under roof. And so as a part of that historical, as a part of that renovation, we're working with the developer and with Preservation North Carolina to create a history center as a part of the new mill so that people who live there will have a sense of history of this place. And as a part of that, we developed a digital archive of 2,500 items relating to the history of the mill and the mill village. And we use Prospect as the platform for that. So we have card views, gallery views, we have timeline views. Prospect also has an AV widget that might be of interest to you if oral history is a part of your research, because it enables you to stream audio from SoundCloud or video from YouTube. And then underneath that streamed media content to have the transcription of what's being said so that you can follow along with the printed transcription to what you're hearing and seeing. And you can jump from any place in the video or audio to another place just by clicking to that place in the transcript. And this will support two languages. So you could have an interview with a filmmaker or someone who's 92 years old who remembers going to the movies in the 1950s. So you've got her interview there. It's being streamed. You've got someone who's able to read it in its original language, that's Italian, but also to be able to read it in another language, German, English, whatever it happens to be. So it's quite powerful and quite flexible.
Silences in the records, you know, and obviously you're looking primarily here at newspaper sources and what's available there, this massive archive that's become available. And then, you know, where you have, for example, you know, Run Race, you know, you find this kind of lack of discussion and that speaks to something itself. And this is something I think we find quite a lot in our research, that obviously what is printed in the newspapers is reflecting, you know, a certain institutional or, you know, ideological perspective and stuff. And then there's a kind of big work of interpretation that has to come in, you know, around those silences. And I wonder if you could say a bit more about that, because then where do you start with your interpretation? You know, do you start then with other sources? Or, you know, kind of, you know, how do you fill in these gaps? Also thinking about, I suppose, information that's coming from above and coming from below?
Well, that's a wonderful question, and I don't know the answer to it. I think, though, that increasingly, or the point I'm trying to make is that increasingly, we're going to have to be able to deal with this enormous discursive environment in much more nuanced and subtle ways than we were in the past. And that part of that is simply means that we aren't going to be able to come to any conclusions. It means that we may come up with a hypothesis, or we may see what happened over here, and we may have a question mark about whether or not something that's kind of related to it also occurs over here. So that the whatever knowledge or understanding that we gain is always going to be provisional, is always going to be contingent, and it's always going to be literally, it's going to be valid only until the next person searching the same material presses.
Newspaper, but also scientific debate, intellectual debate, etc. So I think that what we must do now is organize our work as you are doing. So thank you so much for your invitation.
Bobby, as you always do, every time I've heard you speak, you leave 100 traces for people to think about. Thank you very much. There's one that intrigued me, and I just wanted to ask you to say a bit more about. which was the point where you picked up on the challenges to Durkheim's separation of the sacred and profane. And that really rang with me from things I've done in my researches, but I've not thought it in that way before. And I just wanted to ask you, could you elaborate a bit more on what you understand by that?
Sure. And that's the part of the paper that I cut out to bring it down to.
Well, damn you,
I write 75 page papers that I have to then take about three quarters out of to deliver them. But it, I mean, there is, I think, first of all, a very simplistic notion of what religion was in the United States, and a very equally simplistic notion of its practices and the variety and difference among religious practice, not religious thought, religious practice in the United States. If you look, you can find out, if you want to know what religious practice was like in a place like North Carolina, it's there in the newspapers. It's because a daily newspaper would actually run articles about a revival going on in another part of the state. And when you have religious newspapers, which serve the same function as trade papers that we're familiar with in media, the practices of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of ministers and lay ministers are there documented on a weekly basis. And what you can see is, as I was quoting from Jill Stevenson's recent book, kind of religious performance, and she starts out with the discussion of Mel Gibson's Passion of Christ, which is absolutely fascinating. But she wants to make the point that particularly for these evangelical religious denominations, the Methodists and the Baptists, that they were in the, they're not these traditionalist kind of, we don't want to have anything to do with modernity. They were using modern print culture. They were publishing millions of books. The Methodist Hymnal was the third most purchased book at the beginning of the 19th century. The Methodist. And so whenever a new technology came along, they were experimenting with how that might be used for evangelical purposes. And if you stand back and look at it, it does make sense. Because as soon as radio comes along in the late 1920s and the 1930s, it's religious groups, and particularly evangelists, who are in the forefront of making use of that new technology. You can extend it on board and cable and into other things. So going through, what I'm interested in doing is really in going through and looking at this complex interconnection of religious performance and in the broadest sense and media performance in the broadest sense. And where those two bump up against each other or where they come together. I found one instance, I found a wonderful review when took his panorama, religious panorama, to a town called Goldsboro, North Carolina, in 1881. The Goldsboro newspaper ran a review that said, Mr. Budd is returning, so we know he's been here before, he's returning with his marvelous panorama. And then it said, on this occasion, however, the police should be standing by to make sure that some of the indecorous response that occurred last time does not occur this time, which meant they were clapping. So you don't clap in church. So it's this, what is this occasion? Is it a cinema performance? Is it a religious performance? And what are the audiences supposed to be? Is this supposed to be a devotional exercise? Seriously. Is this an act of piety, a devotional exercise? Or is this an act of entertainment, of pleasure? So are these things mutually inconsistent? I don't know. But I'm really, really eager to get down to that level to kind of work some of these things.
I just wanted to add to that, listening to you. I'm from the Bahamas, and we have a, I mean, so much of what you said just resonates there. But then you were a British colony, so we have that blend, which I'm really trying to figure out. But as you were talking about these traveling, I thought about a crusade. I said, these were actually crusades, and you know, the whole idea of entertainment, but with the religious aspect to it, you know, and definitely you see that so much in particular, because North Carolina is the Bible Belt, is it?
Oh yeah.
Like, so you get that. So much work, yeah. But thank you very, very much. I really need to talk to you one on one. I have so many things.
We need to establish a bummy surgery.
Yeah, because
I wanted sort of this is the. Part of the surgery process that is going on. One thing that you touched upon, and we really felt a little bit when we were working on the Italian Cinema Audiences project, is where film stands, the actual film, and obviously the fact that it's ephemeral, that it's transient, and you know, you're talking about traveling, so it's sort of seen once. I mean, we had similar experience in which in second and third run cinemas they would only have the opportunity to see it for one day, and then sort of would go. But I really felt, while working on the project at the time, film was the neglected aspect of a sort of the Italian cinema audience. And I'm just putting, are we allowed to leave it on the side? It's sort of in what moment you try and bring it in, and this is that the experience that you've had, that in a way it almost becomes one of the, I mean, not obviously the focal element, but there's the fear of really forgetting about that as an aspect. I don't know. This is a sort of
Well, it's certainly the question of what's the status of film and cinema history? Sounds like a really stupid question. It's a really important question. The status of film and cinema history for most of the 40 years in which I've been involved in cinema studies has been, well, that's all it is. Film, it is, the study of film, that is the object of cinema history. And then some people say, well, not exactly, because, for a couple of reasons. If you look, particularly if you look in this early period, film never stands alone. The performance always involves something. And frequently, film is not necessarily the most important thing that people are attracted to the performance by. When illustrated songs become a part of the performance of almost every storefront theater in America between 1906 and around 1914, these are people singing popular songs to the accompaniment of slides, photographic slides, that document the lyrics of the song, right? Called illustrated songs. So these are local performers. And if you read in the newspapers, it's these performers that get a lot more space in the newspapers than the films that are on the same program. And in part, it's because in this early period, films flowed in and out of theaters so quickly that it didn't make any sense to list them in the newspaper, because they'd already gone by the time that the newspaper kept out. I think it's also because there were other things going on and other reasons for people to go to the movies, which may have had absolutely nothing to do with the particular film that was playing at one time. But I do think that the availability of these newspapers gives us an opportunity to go back and take films that have been singled out as being particularly culturally important, and to look to see, A, whether they actually made it to a particular place, when they made it to a particular place, and what do you get? Are the dogs barking, or are the dogs asleep underneath the porch? And there are a couple of films during this early period, boxing films, for example, that are held up as being incredibly popular, and incredibly controversial. Not in North Carolina. That's another one of those silences. So what are you supposed to do with this? Finding that silence does not mean that it's a refutation of the case for the film's importance. It is simply trying to look at the way in which discourse reflects this particular phenomenon of this film's being shown places, and then asking the question, what do we do with this? Which might mean looking for the same thing someplace else, where you've got some data that you can look for it there. But there are some films that I want to go back and look at. Interestingly, I want to go back and look at the Passion Play films. These are films that are talked about in every canonical film history book ever, but no one has done, very few, people have given those panoramas a kind of look to see what they were like. They're criticized for being stagey,
But it's a film of a play. That's what it's supposed to be. No one is expecting a kind of transparency, you know, realistic transparency. These are set up to be staged. So I'll go back and look at this. And look at the panoramas and also what are you.
Okay, I think we can thank Bobby, and I'm sure we'll have the opportunity of go to surgery throughout the next couple of days. Thank you.